Good afternoon. I'm glad to see so many people here want to hear about a patent battle. The more I learn about patent law, the more I realize it is not for me. So my name is Albert. I'm a computational biologist in the same lab as Joe. I apparently am a legal expert, as he claims I am, but I am not. I just happen to be taking a class that's about intellectual capital management alongside James Jeffries over there. So if you've got questions about deep patent law, he's the go-to. Alright, so this is going to be sort of a deep dive into the legal minutiae of this patent battle, and we're going to see clearly what the different lines of attack both sides are employing, and I'm going to try to give a little bit of input on what might happen in the future. Alright, so let's just... not working. A little bit about CRISPR-Cas9. As far as I know, which isn't much, Cas9 is a nuclease, this is a great thing here, that is able to identify and precisely cut DNA in eukaryotic systems, or any DNA in reality. As part of Cas9, there's this other RNA strand called the sgRNA. Half of the sgRNA is on the inside of the Cas9, the other half is on the outside, and that's the part that binds the DNA. And then if you want new DNA to get inserted, you somehow use the native machinery of the eukaryote to insert the new DNA. That's all I know. And there's multiple functions that can come out of Cas9. We're going to principally talk about just the one on the right, which is cutting out some pieces of DNA and then inserting some new pieces. But before I get into the actual patent battle, I need to define what the patent really is. So this slide is shamelessly stolen from our professor. Don't worry, I give him credit. So I'm going to describe this using Uber. So at the very middle, you have a patent. A patent is all about the function. So when you load up the Uber app, the function of the app is that you input your information where you are, and then they carry out some kind of algorithm, some kind of software, pairs you up with the driver. So that software, that is patentable. And indeed, they have patented that. Right on the outside of that, this is a copyright. It's a form of expression. So you look at the Uber app, you see there's these little cars driving around. It's the way they present the instructions, the way they present the map. That is all copyrighted. And on the very outside, we have what's called the trademark. And the trademark is all about identifying who this is from. So that would be the Uber name, those four letters, the icon of the app, etc. But we're going to only talk about the very middle, which is the patent on CRISPR-Cas9. Some properties of patents is that they have to be novel. It's novel. They have to be non-obvious. We'll get into this a little bit later. And they have to be useful. Of course, CRISPR-Cas9 is useful. And then the point of a patent is that you can have a limited monopoly right. Basically, you can say, anyone else is not allowed to use this stuff, make this stuff, or sell this stuff. I have this right if I'm the patent holder. So with CRISPR-Cas9, it's very valuable. Also, you can have inventors on the patent. These are people who came up with it. And then there's the people who actually own it, which can be the assignee. So all of us, every research we do here at Northwestern, that research is owned by Northwestern. So if you have an invention here, you can be the inventor, but you have to assign it to Northwestern. Now for the two sides. So on the left side, we have two principal investigators, Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer Doudna. So Charpentier is in Berlin, and she's sort of managing the European theater of this patent battle. And then Doudna is here in UC Berkeley, and she's managing the US side. So I'm going to mostly talk about Doudna. They, of course, the University of California is funding a lot of their patent battle. And then on the right side, we have the Broad Institute and Professor Feng Zhang. So both of these groups published academically. Doudna and Charpentier published first in 2012, and then Zhang in 2013. But their patents are disputed. So Doudna actually filed her patent first, followed by Zhang. Zhang did it, half a year after? But he actually paid a nominal fee, it's a couple thousand dollars, to fast-track the patent, and actually got pushed through a little bit faster. And he got it. But then, 2 years after that, UC files a patent interference. And interference is just saying, we dispute this patent, we actually own the rights to this. And the Patent and Trade Office says, yeah, this is actually happening. So this is less than a year. This is 10 months old. This patent battle is technically 10 months old. And the latest hearing was in December 6th, so I will build up the story all the way through last month. And if you're wondering, Zhang won just because of the fast track patent, it actually doesn't matter, because if Doudna had been awarded it, Zhang would be the one filing the interference, and we'd have the exact same legal arguments on both sides. Also on this case, it's the first to invent. So right now, the patent system is on the first to file. Whoever files first gets to win. That's how it works. But because their inventions was before that system came to be, it's on the first to invent. So they actually have to provide evidence and proof that they were the first. Turns out, this doesn't matter. You'll find out. As part of the interference, they have to define what's called a count. A count is the legal term meaning what is the specific thing we are going to fight over. And they have multiple counts. This is count one, which is the most important count because it's about eukaryotic, cutting eukaryotic DNA with CRISPR-Cas9. This is the legalese. This is translating it. This is why the lawyers get paid a lot. So this is in March. And as part of the interference, there's two phases of the interference. The first part is the interlocutory phase, and the second part is the testimonial phase. So in part of the first phase, you're going to declare motions. Motion literally is just you telling the judge, we're going to talk about this, and the judge can either say, yeah, we're going to talk about it, or no, or maybe. And that would be, granted means we're going to talk about it, deferred means maybe later, and if you just reject it, you're not allowed to talk about it. And part of these motions, they can motion for issues. Issues is just the different types of arguments, and one issue is the threshold issue. That's the big one, the big umbrella issue. And if you win the threshold issue, you just win. So these are the threshold issues for UC and Broad. Broad was granted the right to talk about their threshold issue, so that's actually a small victory for them. And their argument is the Patent Trade Office, they did their job, they gave us the patents. Everything's fine. There's no issue. UC, of course, says, no, there's an issue. We own this stuff. And then there's the threshold issue, but then there's the little small issues that make up the big argument. You can tell this really doesn't say anything. These are the sort of legal arguments that make up the big issue. And I'm going to translate it into two words each. So let's start on the UC side. They say UC... or UC says Broad, their patent lacks novelty and is obvious. It's an obvious extension of our patents. I'll get into that in the next slide. And then they also allege that Broad's doing a bunch of sketchy, unethical stuff, including unfair authorship. The judges rejected them to talk about this, so they don't believe that has any merit. But this does, potentially. And then Broad, talking about UC, says that their patent was non-detailed enough for a person to replicate. So part of a patent is there must be enough information that a person could, of course, replicate the results. They say that's not enough. Also, they lack novelty. You may ask, how is it possible that both sides accuse each other of lacking novelty? That doesn't make sense. Next slide will explain that. And this is actually a pretty interesting victory. Part of the count, they only talk about Cas9. And Broad set a motion saying, yes, we're only going to talk about Cas9. And the judges said, yes, we are. At the very end, I'll talk about why that's significant. But first, let's talk about what the real core argument. This is the non-obviousness. I thought red doesn't work on this projector.
They fixed it.
Wow. Oh, they fixed it? Okay. Well, I'm glad, because there's red here. So, University of California, they for sure were able to characterize CRISPR-Cas9 in a test tube and in a prokaryote. So this center core, they got that. Even Broad basically admits that they've got that. But as part of a patent, remember a new patent cannot patent stuff that is an obvious extension of a previous. So while UC has this core, they argue that the eukaryotic function of their patent is obvious. So they have this entire area. Broad, on the other hand, says, no, it's not obvious. We did this. We can show that we did it first. So what the heck is obviousness? I'm sorry, this is a slide that is nothing but words. But you came to a presentation about patent law. So what did you expect? obviously, this is pretty difficult. There's a 12,000-word guideline on the Patent Trade Office. I did not look through it because I value my time. But one good definition is something that is obvious is when it's obvious to a person of ordinary skill in the art. And possible rationales, I've convinced. So these are possible rationales. They're not the be-all, end-all. If you meet some of these, it might be enough. It's very subjective. Obviousness becomes a subjective term that you have to provide evidence for in court, and the judges will pass judgment on that. So combining prior art. So we've got the new CRISPR-Cas9 that's been characterized in a prokaryote. And then we've also got a bunch of conventional techniques that can move things into a eukaryote. As it turns out, CRISPR-Cas9 works in a eukaryote just by using those conventional techniques, that prior art, to put it into a eukaryote. So that is a possible rationale that it was obvious. Obvious to try. Once you have CRISPR-Cas9 working in a test tube, of course you should try it in a eukaryote. So that could be a possible rationale. Standard teachings allow a person of ordinary skill in the art to recreate. Those conventional teachings about putting things into a eukaryote, is that a good rationale? So I think this quote really summarizes the very deep argument here. Well, so this is some guy from the NIH who does understand the system. He says, yeah, it is easy to move from a prokaryote to eukaryote, but it's easy enough to be obvious, because it's also, can you predict this is going to happen? If you're gonna try to move something into eukaryote, of course you're gonna try the conventional techniques first, and they happen to work. It's not clear if that's obvious or not. So we're gonna move to December 6th. This is the attorneys from both sides have 20 minutes to talk to the judges, and then I think 5 minutes to give a rebuttal to the other side. And this summarizes UC side. There was nothing special about getting a CRISPR-Cas into a eukaryote. They have evidence showing that 6 labs, after Dowdna published her academic paper, in the 6 months after that, there were 6 groups that got CRISPR-Cas to work in eukaryote. Before that publication, no. That is evidence that maybe it was obvious because they've enabled it. They even looked at Broad's patents as well as their publications, all conventional techniques. That must be obvious. This one I don't really believe, but he gives an argument that, yeah, scientists, they perform experiments when there's a chance that it's going to work. I can believe these two, third one less. On the other side, Broad, they basically say, there's all this evidence that says this is the antithesis of obvious. This is not obvious at all. So Dowdna filed her patent in May 2012. This is half a year after she already published her first findings, but she doesn't have evidence showing that a eukaryotic system worked until October. If it was obvious, wouldn't it be just like that? Wouldn't it be a lot quicker than this? Broad also says that UC says that it's easy. So Broad is not saying it's easy. They still think it's hard. They're saying UC offers evidence saying it's easy. But that's not the same as expecting it's going to work. Just because it ended up being easy doesn't mean going forward at the time you thought it was going to work. And just because it's a strong motivation to put it in eukaryotes, of course, doesn't mean, again, it's going to work. And then I really like this. They found an article, an interview with Professor Dowdna. So this article really portrays her in a really nice light. She's the gung-ho hero. She's figuring out how CRISPR works. She's going to save all diseases, or destroy all diseases, rather. But she has a quote in here, as you can read. She had many frustrations getting CRISPR-Cas9 to work in a human. That's evidence against obviousness. And Broad found that. That's part of their evidence, yes?
Isn't she a bacterial biochemist? So, like, why would you be expected to immediately know how to work with a million cells?
I don't know. I don't have it here, but that is one of the counter arguments that Broad provided, saying that in the 6 months that it got her to get her to work in a eukaryote, she was setting up her lab in a way that she could do it. But she probably had to know how anyways. Adam?
Just context. Does Dowdna and UC have a separate patent on prokaryotic CRISPR? So like that's been granted, that exists, and that's everything then is the eukaryotic system on top of that, or is that not even a patent that exists?
As far as I'm aware, no. Well, they have one patent pending, and it's a big patent.
It's for eukaryotic, it's for everything.
I believe it's for prokaryotic and test tubes, but eukaryotes are an obvious extension of it, so they don't even need to talk about it because they use the obviousness argument.
Yeah, and nobody's fighting that patent, right? Where they're just saying that it's not.
That is the patent between, I mean, that patent versus the Zhang patents, multiple patents, is what's on the table.
But a split that could happen at some point is you get your prokaryotes and then you get.
We're going to talk about it, yeah. That's on the speculation side.
Yeah.
Question about?
Question. Do you know whether, I don't know the answer, but when Dowdna filed the original patent, my guess is that they put in a claim that applied to eukaryotes and potentially the patent office struck it during the conduct of patent office, going to prosecute that patent. So do we know anything about whether there was a claim originally that applied to eukaryotes and it was somehow eliminated during that process?
I didn't read her patent application, so I can't say for sure. My guess is no, just because they have no real information about it at that time. But we're going to find that they're also allowed to modify the patent. So even if it's pending, they can still modify it before it gets granted.
Strategically, that's one thing that can be used, basically, in patent strategy standpoint is if you include something like that and you haven't really made your case strong enough, you can actually screw yourself for patent too, right? Because you then make it obvious, because like past me already said we can do it in eukaryotes. So now present me, it's obvious, even though you didn't get the patent on the first one. So
when we talk about Europe, that exact argument is going to be a big attack.
Okay,
cool. Yeah.
Sorry, also, if I recall correctly, I believe their Dama's original patent submission has something about doing it in yeast. Is that, does anyone know? Because my understanding is that part of their argument from the road is like, yeast to mammalian to human cells is a big joke. It's not exclusively just like bacteria to mammalian cells. I think that there's a point at which yeast was involved.
Okay, so maybe they're a little bit closer than I kind of alluded to. I'm not sure. I didn't read the patents, unfortunately. Okay, so this is anything you say can be used against you. And both sides are going to use this to the fullest extent. But after the end of the day on December 6th, one of the judges, there's three judges presiding over the case, one of them says straight up to UC, I don't really buy this explanation. So we think that Brode is winning this argument right now. And then there's a whole swath of other arguments. So I'm going to start on Brode's side. Let me start on Brode's side. So Eric Sondheimer was a researcher here at Northwestern, actually. And he and another professor, Marafini, they declared publicly that they were going to try getting CRISPR-Cas9 to work in a eukaryote. They tried and they failed. So that is evidence that it's not obvious. After Zhang published his academic document, since then they've had 36,000 requests for CRISPR-Cas9 to work in eukaryotes. And that again is obvious that because we've got this information out, we are the ones that have enabled a person of ordinary skill in the arts to use CRISPR-Cas9 in a eukaryote. Another piece of evidence. And then Cas9, apparently there's different types of Cas9. Type 2 has 6 different types underneath it. And only one of them works in eukaryote. And this is something that they say could not have been predicted until you tried. Another evidence against obviousness. And UC said that there were 6 groups that got eukaryotic CRISPR-Cas9 to work, but 2 of them, Mali and Huang, used materials that were not, or molecules that were not in the original patent filing of Dowda. So again, they switched up something, and the way they switched it up was not obvious, so this might be more evidence. Right now, we're in the interlocutory phase of the interference, meaning it's only the attorneys representing the two sides and the judges talking. There's no expert testimony yet. That's in the testimony phase. We'll get there. So I really like this. UC, the very clever lawyers, they see the exact same evidence that Sondheimer failed. They say, no, Sondheimer failed before we published our document. They didn't do the things we did. We looked at a test tube in a prokaryotic system. We characterized CRISPR-Cas9 perfectly in those systems. And from that, we were able to extrapolate to eukaryote. Because they didn't do what we did, they failed on eukaryote. They were guaranteed to fail. So it was not obvious for Eric Sondheimer. It was obvious for us. So I love this. The lawyers on both sides see the exact same piece of evidence, and they both work it into their own arguments. if you wonder why they pay a lot of money. Brode says, same thing. We fully characterize. Oh no, hold on. This is UC. So Brode at some point actually said yes. UC fully characterized the system in a prokaryote/test tube. And now UC is taking that and hitting them back. It's like, yeah, they admitted to it. He even talks about the little minutia of the experiment. The promoters, the vectors, the microinjection, they're all conventional. This must be obvious. And then that article they used to hit down with, the many frustrations, that's not the same as does not expect it to work. You can be frustrated and expect it to work. In fact, I would argue that usually you're frustrated when you expect it to work, but it doesn't. So they say, why is it working? That piece of evidence you have, it's not the same. There's a question.
So she said many frustration trying human cells, right? But human cells is not, eukaryote and human cells are different things. She didn't say many frustrations to try eukaryotes. She just said human cells. And eukaryotic cells cover more than human cells.
That is true. I haven't seen that as an argument yet, but maybe it'll come up. I saw a hand somewhere. Yes?
I want to bring up back to one of my
science, these judges here, are they trained in what's obvious in a specific field of science, or how do they see what is obvious? Because obviously it has a definition depending on subject matters.
I'm going to give the answer that our professor always gives, is that obviousness is subjective to the evidence that is presented and the arguments that are presented. They are probably experts in obviousness as in like all the legal precedent beforehand, but up until here, they have to define it themselves. So I don't know, there's no objective way to say it, to figure it out. Okay, so that's pretty much all we're going to talk about of obviousness for now. But as I mentioned earlier, UC can win this if they can invalidate Broad's patents in any tactic possible, including this stuff, bad faith. So let's talk about that. So this guy, Shuai Yang Lin, or Dr. Lin as I will talk, he was a researcher at Broad 2011 to 2012. So this is before anyone published about CRISPR-Cas9, 2011. He's actually an inventor on Broad's first patent, so he's not just some random guy. He actually was part of the patent. He basically emails UC saying, I can help you with the patent. Also, that's the actual title. perhaps subtlety is not his specialty. these are actual quotes. So you see here, his lab notebooks, even email correspondences, that's all evidence that he's going to use to say that Broad was failing at the CRISPR-Cas9 until Jennifer Doudna published. He also said, I was the only one working on CRISPR-Cas9, and that Zhang was failing at it until you published. Also, there's this thing called the Zhang supporting document. He says it's misrepresented. This is, yes?
Yeah, question. Did Dr. Zhang run over Dr. Lin's dog? Car or something? What the background is behind
the I cannot find a lot of information about this guy because he doesn't.
Okay. That is my sarcastic.
I know. Actually, in two slides, I'll give you why he.
Okay.
There's this supporting document. So part of the patent application process is once you submit a patent, 18 months after submission, your patent becomes open to the public, regardless of the decision on the patent. But alongside the patent, so after Zhang filed this patent, they also sent a 15-page document to the examiner of the patent that was extra information that supported his patent. I don't think that's public because that's not part of the actual application. I cannot find it. And I'm also So the list of exhibits right now is over 600 items long. Most of them are academic documents, some of them are emails. I'm not going to read through them and figure out which one was Zhang's supporting document, so just leave that there. But UC claims this is, quote, from their actual transcript. This document misrepresents material, basically. So if this comes out to be true, then Broad's patents could be invalidated. So Broad, of course, is not going to take this idly. They're going to counter. So this speaks to his motivation. They don't say anything about Lin's motivation. They just kind of put up these dots, and we're expected to connect them, because it's easy to connect them. They say, his visa expires March 1st. March 1st. And Broad says that they also notified Dr. Lin that he was not going to receive a Broad job in February 2015, which the last working day of February 2015 would have been Friday, February 27th. So I wonder, we're connecting dots here, but they don't allege anything. Yes, question?
Is he a grad student or a postdoc?
When he was at Zhang's lab, right now I know he's a postdoc at UCSF. When he was in Zhang's lab, I actually don't remember. I think he was a grad student.
Because it makes a difference what time exactly it's on.
Oh, that's interesting. I don't know about that. Yes.
Was he also under like an NDA from the Broad, and could he potentially kind of like bring down the hammer on him for doing this kind of thing?
They haven't mentioned. Well, if he was NDA, Broad would have brought that up by now.
Okay.
So probably not.
I was saying the same thing, because like here, I can't say here are my lab notebooks, Northwestern owns them, I don't have any part of that, right? It's like theft if I gave somebody my lab. Am I wrong in that contention, right? Like, I couldn't like hand my lab notebooks over, those are Northwestern's property, right? So it would be like theft for me to give you my lab notebooks that prove this thing, and I would think that wouldn't be admissible in any way.
That's a great question. They're definitely Northwestern property.
Yeah.
I don't know if that is classified as theft, yeah. But it sounds like money.
Or what Rhodes policy is on that.
Exactly.
That would be a pretty bad. That would be bad. And so Lin is saying that Zhang was failing at CRISPR-Cas9. Rhodes says, they basically saying, no, we were actually successful at CRISPR at the time. We just were holding on to results for a bigger paper, which is probably the truth. But we don't know. This is all just hearsay. Speaking of which, back in October, so all this evidence came to light by March of last year. In October, both sides were given the opportunity to file motions about each other's evidence. So hearsay is just any statement, anything someone says outside of the courtroom. So it could be anything, but that's up to the judges to determine the validity of it being hearsay or not. So they're saying the emails, the correspondences, including those from Dr. Lin, as well as other researchers, that's all hearsay. I don't know what the contents of many of these emails are because it's not public. Maybe after the case settles, I think it will be. They also have some legal presence. Dr. Lin, he's a former employee. Former employees do not speak for us, and they even cite some other legal thing. UC, on the other hand, does the pretty much the same tactic. Grode is using down the seminal paper and taking excerpts from it and saying, this statement right here means eukaryotic is not obvious. Grode says, no, you're taking that out of context. We move to get rid of this. And also there's other articles, including the one that says many frustrations. That's all hearsay, because it's statements made outside of the court. As of right now, I don't know if any of, this was in October, I don't know if the judges passed any decision on the motions. I couldn't find any information about that. So that's still pending. So this is, I give sort of the arguments, the different lines of attack for the threshold issue. So this is all past stuff. Jacob Shirkow, he's one of the legal scholars that's commenting a lot about this. He says this threshold issue might end in February. And by ending, it could be one side wins, it could be they move into the testimonial phase, or it could be just dragged on even more. But it's expected maybe to this part to end. But there are options available to UC. So we might think Broad is in the lead right now. I would agree with that. But UC can actually change things. And part of the first interference, the judges gave UC the option to change the count. Remember, the count is the thing we're arguing over. And they said very boldly once, and these are serious people, so when they bold something, you know it. They can do something like the sgRNA, they were able to characterize that system pretty well. And if they can patent the function of the sgRNA binding to CRISPR-Cas9, then maybe they can kind of push Broad out of that space. And it doesn't have to be a new count. Or rather, it doesn't have to modify the count. They can actually take their big count and split it up. Because that first count was just about CRISPR-Cas9 working with eukaryotes. They can split it up into different pieces. This is some weird legalese thing. Apparently saying outside of a prokaryote and eukaryote are legally different, and that could be a change on the count. I don't get that, but whatever. And Jacob, again, has commented that these different switch-ups, these sort of little judo moves they can do, it's all tactics to secure as much intellectual property as possible. So originally, UC's strategy was to get all or nothing. They were going to win the entire space or nothing at all. It looks like they can't do that, so they're going to try and use tactics to win as much as they can. Remember earlier I said Cas9? Rhodes was saying, we're only going to talk about Cas9. Well, that's because sometime afterwards, they found another nucleus that has a very similar function to Cas9, that CPF one. And this is pretty firmly in Professor Zhang's court. UC probably can't touch it. So no matter what, Broad's going to walk away with some intellectual property, and they can use CPF1. I don't think the patent has come out yet for that, but it's going to at some point. Oh, and I like this guy's perspective. He says, despite what they're fighting over now, if someone finds an improvement, they are going to own that improvement, and that would be untouchable. So both sides are, of course, throwing money at improvements on CRISPR-Cas9. But But everything I've talked about is just the U.S., and the U.S. is not the world. I would say right now, the CRISPR-Cas9 patent battle is in the middle of that. They're swinging at each other, they're providing their evidence, and so on. The European theater hasn't quite started, but it's about to. So this speaks to the European system. They have something called a priority filing. You think of a priority filing as like a mini patent. As you discover more information about your patent, you give a priority filing that says, we discovered this little piece that's novel. As long as you verify it, we own this little piece, no one can attack it. Both sides have priority filings. Dauna made a mistake. She put her priority filings after some of her papers were published. And once your papers are published, that information is no longer novel. That priority filing might be invalid, and people are attacking. There are third-party organizations that are now attacking that priority filing, so not so good for her. And the European theater looks a lot like the US theater. Zhang actually has 7 patents, smaller patents around CRISPR-Cas9. Dauna has a single big one pending, but all 7 of these patents that Zhang owns are opposed by third-party organizations. One of them has the big one, the important eukaryotic one, has 9 parties opposed, which is quite high. Those parties are allowed to be anonymous, so I think 5 of them, we know their identities, 4 of them we don't. Almost guarantee that one of those 4 is UC, and the other 3 may be agents working through UC. So as far as I'm aware, they haven't gone to court yet, but I'm not entirely sure. So I think the European version has just about started. There's not nearly as much media about the European front for whatever reason. So how expensive is this getting? Quite, is the answer. So this was published in August, so about half a year ago. Editas is one of the biotechs that's licensing CRISPR-Cas9 from Broad, and as part of their licensing agreement, they are indemnified to Broad, meaning they'll pay the legal bills for Broad. And they already said, we have paid $15.6 million, and that's August. Remember, the interference started in March. I'm sure the lawyers were working very diligently in several years beforehand, because they knew this interference was coming. UC Berkeley had some statements saying they spent $5 million. And Jacob, he again gives us some nice perspective. He says, this is a lot, this is getting crazy. The median is about $7 million, so we're way past that. Both sides said that they're probably gonna spend around $10 million. We're already past that, and we're less than a year into this interference. And I really like his statements at the end, which is, no matter who wins or loses, the lawyers will certainly win. Cool, thanks. You might ask, given that a total of $20 million plus has already been spent, is this worth it? There's a bunch of biotechs that they don't have a single product. They don't have anything on the market. They're not selling anything. And yet you can see their valuations are almost a billion, quarter of a billion. And most of their technologies are based on licensing CRISPR-Cas9 out from whoever wins. And so if you're affiliated with, say, Broad, you will get more favorable licensing because you're affiliated with them. Part of a license has a field of use. So if you're the patent holder, you have all these different uses that you can divvy up. You can give certain field of uses to one party. And if they're a party that you're friends with, of course you can give them more favorable uses. So the companies on both sides are watching this court case very closely, because whichever side loses, their stock's gonna go down a lot, because they're not going to be able to use CRISPR-Cas9 as much as they wanted to. So let's say, thought experiment, that this patent is worth $1 billion. And let's say you think you have a 10% chance of winning that patent. 10% is not great. That's pretty low. But that means you'd be willing to throw up to 10% of $1 billion. That's $100 million. And we already see that this valuation is potentially more than $1 billion. So the $20 million that they spent already, it's nowhere close to what they might be willing to throw at this. And the reality is, that, so if I can give speculation or predictions on what's going to happen, I'm going to guess that this is going to get dragged on a lot and a lot and a lot, because we're in the interlocutory phase, and I'm going to assume that if UC really believes they're about to lose, they're going to change the count to something else that's in their favor. I don't know what that's going to be. I'm sure their lawyers are working very hard on that. And then even if a decision is made in this interference, it can get appealed into the federal court, and this could go all the way up to whatever federal court level they want to. Also, interferences do not have settlements, usually. It's because when you declare an interference, you are saying, there's this territory that is mine, that someone else is sitting on right now. we're going to fight to the bitter end. If you want to make a settlement, you make a settlement before the interference. So the patent office actually straight up says we discourage interference. We discourage settlements. If you make a settlement in an interference, one, that settlement must be public information. No one wants a settlement to be public information. Neither party wants that, so that's discouraging already. And two, the judges, the three judges overseeing the interference they have control over it. They actually mediate the settlement, which of course takes the power out of both sides. And so settlements are very rare. So if they thought that was an option, it's probably not gonna happen. They're gonna fight to the bitter end until someone wins. So that's pretty much the entire case. I ended on a negative note, so let's bring the mood up. I like this guy. He says, whatever happens, whoever wins, let's just hope it helps the general public at the end of the day. That's all I got. Any questions?
Yes? Kind of question. What if in one side UC wins and say Broad wins in the US, but say UC wins in Europe, what actually happens?
Oh, geez. One of them gets the Europe market, and one of them gets the US market. James, do you have...
My pick. You just license it from a different company, depending on where you were selling the therapeutic.
I remember, selling, making, and using the therapeutic.
Right.
So, and that can happen. In fact, there's a French company, this came out in October, Selectus. They have a very broad patent that they claim covers a lot of nucleases, including Cas9. That's their claim. So if you thought it was just UC versus Broad, there's this other company, French company. They got a US patent about that. They're probably going to fight now too. So it's embroiled the entire globe at this point.
All the same thing, are there any cases where a drug is not available in one country because of the patent battles?
I can say that if there is a patent battle, that will raise the level of uncertainty about who owns that patent, which means people don't want to put money into the company that wants to use that patent. So from an industry standpoint, no one in industry wants a patent battle to play out. I have it summarized here. And we've already seen that money is starting to slow down. R&D efforts have slowed down. All companies want a quick resolution if their side went out. This patent battle means that no one wants to put money into it, which means no one's going to use it. Quentin?
So patents last for 17, 20 years. When does the clock start? Is it when the case ends or when they file?
I think it's 20 years when you file, 17 when you are granted the patent, depending on whichever is longer. So if it takes a long time for the
So it'll be when it's settled plus 17 years.
Yeah.
Or 20 for filing.
So even if this takes 5 years, for example, it would be considered when they both filed.
Yeah.
This is maybe a dumb question and kind of self-serving because I use CRISPR but not the patent on it. But could the U.S. government just buy out both your patent rights and then like say, all right, everyone wants to do applications. Build your application patents on this baseline to build there.
Governments are not allowed to own the patent right now. Yes?
Have you read anything about, in Europe it's first to file, and at the time that this was filed, it was first to invent in America. It seems like both systems have problems. Is there any way that people like legal scholars have proposed to get around this issue?
So as it turns out, the first to file and the first to invent is irrelevant because they're arguing over obviousness. One of them says, yeah, we're earlier, but things you're trying to do, we got covered by obviousness. The other one says, no, that's not obvious. So the first to file, first to invent, actually the system doesn't matter for this, because these arguments are still valid under both systems.
I think we have time for one more question.
Okay. Or not.
Not a question. I wanted to mention that Nature Biotech, the current edition, has a very interesting discussion on how licensing of CRISPR is going to be determining what uses can be allowed in terms of ethics. So using licensing to regulate the ethics of applying CRISPR to, for example, human germline editing. So definitely worth a read.
With that, let's thank Albert for the fantastic presentation.